of education. How many times have we had it in this country that majority of the teachers we have in primary and primary schools are not even better than many of their students? You see, this is a big problem. And it has to do with one, what kind of people do you incentivize to go into teaching? How did people get into teaching? Look at the national curriculum for the colleges of education. The curriculum, until about 2 years ago when we raised the alarm, the curriculum for the colleges of education has nothing to do with primary education curriculum. Yet, the national policy said when you have NCE, you will teach in primary school. And the curriculum you use in training teachers at the NCE has no bearing whatsoever. NCE has become a stepping stone to go into universities. You see, so the question is, how do we need to refocus on the curriculum of the colleges of education and tailor it to the curriculum of primary education. That is one. Two, how do we ensure we give on-the-job quality training to teachers? A lot of interesting things are already happening across the country, supported by international donor agency. But how do we scale it up to ensure that teachers get on-the-job training? Thirdly, how do we incentivize brilliant people to take up career in teaching? You know, because as long as someone came to me once and said, please help my son to get a job, even if it is teaching. So in other countries, in Japan, for example, it's only the most brilliant and the brightest that teach in primary school.
When people are asked to bring figures or data, they automatically think it's going to translate to higher resources for the federal government, or it's going to translate to more constituencies for them, it's going to translate to more benefit. Because everywhere in the world that I know, the issue of data is birth and death, mostly. And they should be left to, at worst, the state. There should be enough trust between the center and the federal units for you to be able to rely on the data being supplied by the states. Because when people give birth, they don't give birth at the federal capital. They give birth where they live. When people die, they die in situ. Now, so there's need for that, synergy and trust between the state, the local government, state, and federal level. Two is that, like I said, we must not look at simple issues of data as being political. Most of the figures we are working with today are completely exaggerated. I'll give you an example. When the GSM was introduced, I know two companies that hired international consultants to give them data to convince them whether or not she should participate in the auction. Working on the data available, the consultant advised them that it would take 5 years for the subscribers, for the company to have 1 million subscribers. Based on that information, they refused to participate in the auction. It took less than 6 months for both, then I think it used to be Celtel, Econet, and the MTM to reach 5 million. The death of reliable data, that's what it cost them. Now, today, we work with data which we cannot even, the integrity of which we are not sure of. So please let there be thorough decentralization of data and let people don't look at data as, political. And I think that's what we're going to get there.
The other question has to do with UB.
I think, yes, it is true that many states today are yet to access the UBE funds. But what we are not being told is that UBE funds are not accessible without, meeting certain conditions. The first is that you as a state must be able to meet your own counterpart funding. Two, you must also be able to show the federal government what we did with the last the last UBE fund you took. But I think the real problem about UBE is that states are very upset that the federal government will nominate contractors to come and do projects, you know, for them on UBE.
Let me tell you my experience where I like this talk. You see, you say I bring 1.2 billion, you give me 1.2 billion. And you tell me that 70% of that must be used for infrastructure. Now, if I think my priority is teacher training, for example, then I'm obliged to spend that money on building infrastructure once I collect it, regardless of whether 50% of it is my money. You see, this has discouraged many states. So they say, okay, keep your 1.2 billion. Let me keep up my 1.2 billion and spend it on what I consider to be my priority. That is one. The second element, why should federal government buy books for states? You see, this is a major problem. When I was commissioner, a publisher brought a book to me, very good books. But these books presume that children have done 2 years of pre-primary education. But we know that majority of children in public schools come straight from their home into primary one. So these books did not account for that. But when someone sits in Abuja and now award contracts to publishers to supply books to states, then it's not going to work. So you see, so what we are saying is that there are a whole lot of governance system here. APC is a federalist party. We believe that states should be allowed to do the work that states are constitutionally charged to do, while the federal government set the overall policy and standards. But all this is about people awarding contracts. That's what is distorting all these.
Thank you very much, PDP.
The issue about data, you're very correct. It speaks the truth to our history. We are a developing country. Just yesterday, there were no data anywhere. But of course, there are data today. That's why we're having the arguments about somebody bringing a spurious certificate that we say, no, it's not true. Data elsewhere shows that certificate doesn't exist. So, data are very, very important. And we believe in education. That's why we insist that people should do those things that they say they will do. Now, I can give you that there is already data in Nigeria. A lot of people are building their own data because I know when the police are building its own data. Today in INEC, we have problem about data, about the data that they should provide the citizens, not being yet given to up to 20 million people. And that's why some people are saying, oh boy, are you ready for the elections? So issues like that data, yes, you need to understand because some of the things that go into data provision are not procured locally, just like the INEC crisis seems. If it were a local contract with the Nigeria Minting Company, I don't think we may be where we are now. But because they have to expect foreign contractors to provide them with those data cards for more than 25 million people, that's where a lot of people still do not have. Please, we are a developing country. We are doing the best that we can. But of course, we mean very well in issues of data. That's why we're insisting that whoever says he did WAEC, WAEC does have their own word, databases, and bring your certificate. Let us see if it is real.
I think it also borders on the governors beyond the federal government, especially with the UBEC fund. And this is where we need to address the critical issue beyond political affiliations. The UBEC is not only about federal government, and the fund domicile there is owned by Nigerian people. It is deducted from the federation account. So the governors don't have the excuse of saying, because UBEC is giving that condition, then you allow that money to be stolen because it is not utilized. That is one. Because once it is there, domicile and not tapped, then somebody steals it. Then we will start looking for how 54 billion naira disappear from UBEC. That is one. Two, with the case of insecurity in the Northeast and with the experience with the Chibok girls, pending when the crisis there is resolved, how do we guarantee the safety and security of the teachers, the properties, and in terms now looking at the classes that have been built, And then the children that will be going there. It is not just about those military going there. There must be a strategy from the parties that clearly addresses these issues. Thank you.
Well, I think it's I think nothing advertises the incompetence of this government more than that one single issue of the kidnap of 260 girls in broad daylight. You see, people start talking about how do we guarantee the lives of teachers, the lives of people who are going to conduct elections. Do you know today how many Nigerians in the Northeast are internally displaced? Do you know the mindset of the average person from the Northeastern part of Nigeria, the insecurity? You see, until you have a holistic approach to counter-terrorism, and you are able to secure Nigerians, you cannot even secure just the teachers alone, or just secure the INEC officials alone. It's a crying shame that we will be living in a country and children will be kidnapped on a daily basis and the government will have absolutely no answer. What is even worse, that it took this government a whole 10 days to even accept that these girls have been kidnapped. Talk less of looking for them. And we are campaigning for election today, for president, you know, for re-election, and nobody is talking about what is happening to those Chibok girls. Nobody is talking about where they are. They have relations, they have mothers, they have fathers, but this means being swept aside. And what are we entertained with? Irrelevancies. Now, to go back to your question, sir, until and when you have a real commander-in-chief that can secure the whole of this country, and not just teachers, I think we are just joking. We need a commander-in-chief who can assure me that whether I live in the Northeast, or I live in the Southwest, or I live in the South-South, I will not be a victim of militancy, I will not be kidnapped, there will be no armed robbery, and there will be no, you know, insurgency. That, I think, is the situation.
President Obasanjo was president of Nigeria, and then the politicians in the Northeast and the Northwest introduced the political Sharia that was used to radicalize those areas, and the Sharia mutated today into the violence you call the Boko Haram. And this is what it is. So we are saying, still to go there, these same politicians are the ones that has run into the APC. And that's why we're saying most of them who are there are the ones who know the truth about not only the kidnappings, but also the violence in the country. Let us tell ourselves the truth. The fact that Masop were peopled by Igbos doesn't mean that me and Igbo agree on their strategies in resolving the Nigerian conundrum. We also saw this in the Southwest with the OPC formed when the young people of Yoruba land were not happy with the way their elite engaged with Nigeria. So I believe in resolving the insecurity problem in the Northeast and the Northwest, we have to consult the elders and the elite of those areas, just like we did in Niger Delta, to reach out to their young people and stop this violence.
From my assessment, the Zulu Nigeria, I know that one teacher, one primary school teacher, teaches all the subjects, both mathematics, English. And that's the perception that children finish from primary school with a perception that mathematics is a very difficult subject, definitely, and they will fail in their YA Koneku. So my question is, how do you intend to ensure that professionals in that field teach the subject?
One of the major challenges for that is the nature of the primary school curriculum. I think today they have 16 subjects in primary school. I think about 16 subjects in primary school. I mean, what... Is it 12? I mean, what we are saying is that whether it's 12 or 16, the important thing is that we have too many
silence,
subjects
please,
in
silence.
We have too many subjects in primary schools. We need to reduce the number of subjects. Because what does a child before the age of 10 really need? Ability to do basic arithmetic, ability to read, and ability to write. Any other thing is just addition. So we need to streamline the curriculum, and that's why what APC intends to do. streamline the curriculum in such a way that children will leave primary school literate and able to do basic arithmetic. Now, that would also change the nature, because in primary school, actually, it is possible for one teacher to teach all the subjects in one class. That's what you call class teaching, rather than subject teaching. So, but if you have 16 subjects, there's no way one teacher can teach all the number of subjects. There are some villages that teachers don't want to go. And it means that you have to provide accommodation, you have to provide all that, and they still don't want to go. Now, the solution to that is to make the number of subjects manageable in such a way that a teacher who has gone through secondary school and NCE should be able to teach primary school literacy, should be able to teach primary school numeracy. It becomes a problem when you get to JSS3 and you have integrated science and all that. Then you have to direct the attention. And that is why the NCE program covers not only primary school, but also JSS3. So these are all part of the systems reform that we are talking about. And unless we focus on these difficult, but they are very difficult issues. Unless we focus on these very difficult issues, we are not going to be able to solve the crisis in our education sector.
I don't think the problem should be about just curriculum, like the last speaker just said. Be that as it may, I want us to also recall that the PDP in government has done a lot in terms of curriculum at all levels of education, both primary, secondary, and even JAM. I think what the problem is there is what we are already addressing as part of the initiative. Training the teachers so that they can turn out to be quality teachers. If you are a teacher and you're able to take 10 subjects effectively, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But in order not to labor the teacher so much, the PDP in government is also having that policy in mind to make sure that at least a teacher can only take 2 or 3 courses at a time in order not to overlabor that teacher. And to do that, you agree with me that the budget of the federal government has tripled from 207